the time allotted for the break, as well as for the poster viewing, was sufficient for you all. And I hope that it went well for everyone. And moving on to the next event, I would like to pass on the event to the chair official, Professor Thomas Persch, to guide the third session of our event. Thank you.
Yeah, then hello everybody, also from my side, and a very warm welcome to the session. And I'm very glad that I have the opportunity to share it here at this very interesting conference. And most particularly, I'm very glad that we have a line of very interesting talks. And we will begin with an invited paper, which is invited paper 5, given by Laura Lechuga from the Catalan Institute of Nanoscience and Technology in Spain, who's already here. And she will present on a very timely topic, namely on the nanophotonic biosensors for COVID-19 detection. And I'm looking forward to this speech.
Okay. Hello, good morning or good afternoon to everybody. Can you hear me well, Thomas? It's okay, the sound? Yes, okay. So good morning and good afternoon to everybody from the very beautiful city of Barcelona in Spain, where we are now in summer, in holidays, but okay. So I am going to share my screen. Hope it's okay. Let me know if it's okay, the presentation, please. Can you hear? Okay, can you see the presentation? Okay, so today I'm going to present, our work, what we're doing in nanophotonic biosensor for COVID-19 detection. But before that, I would like also to give just a brief introduction about nanophotonic biosensors. So what we can do with optics to do these really ultra-sensitive devices, and how all these devices can allow us this COVID-19 detection. So just starting, I want to highlight the following, how the clinical diagnosis is done today. So normally, as you probably know, when we don't feel well, we go to see our doctor, and then they are just asking us to take some specialized and some tests. For example, we have all the laboratory techniques like ELISA, PCR. I know that everybody knows now by now what is PCR. Microbiology, culture, chromatography, imaging techniques. What I mean is that normally we have very sophisticated and very excellent laboratory techniques for the diagnostic. But at the same time, these techniques have also some problems. For example, normally they are very time consuming. Sometimes they need a very high sample volume. You need always trained personnel to perform all these analysis in a centralized laboratory. You need all these laboratories, and sometimes the instrumentation is very bulky or is even very expensive. Imagine, for example, if you have to go for a colonoscopy or for a computer tomography. All these techniques are really excellent ones, but expensive and also not available to everybody in the world. So what we see, and especially in the post-pandemic times, is that the main goal in diagnostic is to be able to have small devices where you can deploy just a drop of your blood, a drop of saliva, a drop of even a tear. You can deploy in this very small device, what we call a point of care device. And then you can have a very fast and instant diagnosis by the bedside. You can have even at home. You can have, this analysis in any time and any place where you need. For example, this is one of the last models that from the glucose biosensor that is a wearable or an implantable one that has been released by the company Abbott a few years ago. And probably you have seen some people wearing this implantable biosensor where it's standing in the arm of the patient for 14 days. And then you have a reader, you pass the reader very close to the biosensor and then you can get an instant diagnostic. So what we need is to develop all these kind of biosensor, and this biosensor provide a possibility to create all these point of care devices that contain all the functionalities of an analytical laboratory. So the idea that in the future, and I hope in the very, very near future, we're going to have all these kind of biosensor devices where they allow for easy diagnostic with a very high sensitivity in a very fast way, What is more important, they have to be reliable, and also they have to give a quantitative value. And also all these devices must have multiplexing capabilities. And the idea is also that have to be user-friendly with a minimum operation and also with a minimum sample. And of course, at a competitive cost in such a way that you can use in any country around the world. Okay, this has been the problem with the diagnosis of the COVID-19 until now, because as probably you know, the three ways to detect the COVID-19 is based on or in nucleic acid tests, mainly using the detection of the virus genomic RNA of the SARS-CoV-2, based mainly in all the PCR techniques, not only PCR, real-time reverse transcription PCR, but also many other variants. This is a very excellent technique, as you know, has been the golden technique in the manage of the pandemic, but it's a very well established with high scalability, but at the same time, it's also time consuming. You need this trained personnel, it's centralized, and normally it's also very costly. So we have another way to detect the COVID-19, the direct detection of the virus, so the intact virus, the fragments, so the recognition of the viral antigens. And then we have also seen that there have been released in the last year many rapid tests for this antigen detection. So the main advantage is that all of them has a high scalability, they are low cost, they are very fast, and you can use in a decentralized way. But as you know, also all these rapid tests only give you a yes, no. If there is no quantification of your viral load, the sensitivity is also very bad. So it's not completely reliable. So the serological test is also an indirect way to detect who has been infected. And also there is many techniques like this rapid serological test. And they have also the same problem that the antigen rapid test. I mean, they have very low cost, they are very fast, but then the main problem is the sensitivity and also that they provide quantification. So in our opinion, probably what we can do is to use a point of care photonic biosensor in such a way that then you can have this very easy diagnosis at the point of need with a very high sensitivity and selectivity, and also because they can allow the quantification. And this is very important in the management of the pandemic. If you can know when a patient is arriving to the hospital, what is the viral load? Okay, so just to remember very basic things, what is a biosensor? Just in a biosensor, we have a transducer in contact with a biological receptor layer. So in such a way that this biological receptor layer is completely selective to the molecule that you want to analyze in a very complex sample. So remember the name of biosensor is coming because you are joining a biological receptor with a physical transducer. So all together is what we call biosensor. As transducer, we can use many different ones, like electrochemical, mechanical, optical. As biological receptor, we can use antibodies, enzymes, actin, and many others. So biosensor can detect any kind of substance with a very high sensitivity. So the mechanism is the following. This biological receptor is able to detect in a very selective way the analyte that you want to detect. And then when there is detecting by the biological receptor, there is a physicochemical chain here at the interface that can be read in real time by the transducer. Okay, so probably the most well-known biosensor in the world is the glucose biosensor. This is a biosensor that is used by millions of people every day around the world. As I said before, there is a new model from Abbott where you have already this glucose biosensor in an implantable, wearable way. There is also some pregnancy tests. There is many other biosensors on the market. But remember, when we're speaking about biosensor, it's not only the way to make the biosensor. So it's not only how you make this sensor and how you the transducer and how you join with the biological receptor. It's also that you have to implement a complete device. So you have to do a complete engineering to be able to offer this point of care biosensor. So means that you have also to think about how to introduce the sample. If you need a microfluidic cartridge, sometimes even some kind of sample preparation. In the case of the optical biosensor, you're going to need the light sources, you're going to need detectors, some electronics, some battery, and so on, and some connectivity also with wireless connectivity. So means that you have to open your mind, it's not only to make the a fundamental science, how to develop the biosensor, but it's also how to integrate and to do a complete engineering of a complete device. Okay, so in photonic biosensor, the main principle that we're using for the detection is the vanishing wave principle. Comparing with other type of biosensor, because normally biosensors are using electrochemical transduction. But in the case of the using optics and using photonics, we normally have an ultra sensitivity. So this is the main advantage while using light for making our transducer, this optical transducer. Also because with optics, we can have a level of miniaturization, we can have a high level of multiplexing, and what is more important, we can have a label free. Label free means that we can detect in a direct way any kind of molecule without any amplification, without any fluorescent label, and also we can perform a real-time analysis. So the way to do that is the evanescent wave principle. So this is the main technique for the optical biosensor, where what we monitor is just the local refractive index chain that is taking place at the sensor surface. So as you know, when the light is traveling any waveguide, the light is transmitted through these electromagnetic modes, and then the electromagnetic modes of the light, they have also this evanescent tail that is going out from the sensor surface, and they have this exponential decay. So normally, depending on the material that you are using for your optical waveguide, the wavelength that you are using, so this evanescent wave sensing, this evanescent wave field have penetration in the outer medium between 100 to 900 nanometers. So meaning that we have enough space where to allocate our biological receptor. So the sensor is working in the following way. When there is a binding event on the surface, there is a local change in the refractive index on the surface of the waveguide. And this local change in the refractive index induces a change in the optical in any of the optical parameters of the light that is traveling in the optical waveguide. For example, we can monitor at the end a change in the intensity, in the phase, in the polarization, in the resonant momentum, whatever. But then this change of the optical parameter is completely related with the number of molecules that have been recognized on the surface of the waveguide. So if we make a comparison, if we make a study, what is the state of the art? What has been published or has been presented at the international level? So we can see that in the evanescent photonic biosensor, there are two main branches. So on one is are the nanoplasmonic biosensor that using gold in order to excitate this evanescent wave, or we have silicon photonic sensor, all of them using microelectronics technology for fabrication. And just in the last time that they are now have this new name of photonics integrated circuits for biosensing. And also inside the silicon photonic biosensor, we have two main architecture. We can use an interferometric readout, or we can use a resonant readout. So this is more or less what has been presented at the international level. So we have these very well-known branches of nanoplasmonic biosensor, and then we have the silicon photonics, mainly microwave resonator or interferometric devices. And also we can use a kind of special type of waveguide. For example, we can use photonic crystal, silicon wire, slot waveguides, wavelength waveguide to make this interferometer to make this ring resonator. So this is what you can find at the international level in photonic biosensor. But I would like to make a comparison, because of course we have many of these biosensors, but probably you are thinking, okay, which one is the best? Which one is better to use, for example, for the detection of the COVID-19? So this is a comparison that I have made, just taking number from the literature. And then the comparison is done in the detection limit, mainly what is the minimum amount per square millimeter that the biosensor is able to detect. And then there is a comparison between the bulk sensitivity, so it's the minimum value of the refractive index units that the biosensor is able to detect. So you can see that all of them are really performing very well. So all of them are very sensitive. But it would make Just a close look, we can see that all the ones based on interferometry are the most sensitive ones. So we can't even achieve an astonishing limit of detection at 0.01 picogram per square millimeter. And we can go close to 10 minus 8, 10 minus 9 in sensitivity in the refractive index units. In any case, I want to also just to highlight that when you're working with plasmonic, with gold technology, plasmonic offer a very simple biosensor. It's have a very easy bioconalization protocol. I mean, the way to introduce the biological receptor is have a very relevant sensitivity in any case. And also the instrumentation is very simple. So in the case of the interferometer at the most sensitive one, so we have to take this into account. And you can see also for the, I mean, when we're fabricating with silicon photonics, of course, we can get this ultra sensitivity, the high level of multiplexing. So you can have hundreds of devices in the same chip. And also you can miniaturize, you can integrate, can be really portable point of care devices. And also because we are using just a standard microelectronics technology, you can produce in a mass way and also with a very low cost. Remember that normally in this area, in the biosensing area, and especially for the clinical diagnostic, all the biosensors are going to be single use. And this is why it's so important to fabricate low cost biosensor and also low cost point of care devices. Okay, in my group, we have been working for many years with plasmonic biosensor. I'm going to explain in detail. But in our case, we developed just point of care biosensor using standards with fast plasmon resonance or standard golfing of nanometric dimension. But in our case, we fabricate on the sensor and we integrate in a complete portable devices. So this is what we have until now. Two channel biosensor is really a very reliable and a very simple biosensor. We have also developed localized SPR biosensor using gold nanostructures. So mainly we're using gold nanodiscs. We're using also nanograding. We're fabricated using Blu-ray disc. We have been able also even not only to produce the device, but I mean, not only to produce the transducer and the sensor, but also to integrate in very small devices with one channel, four channels and so on, also with very, good sensitivity. So, we develop everything in-house. But in my group also, we invented or we just presented to the community a new kind of interferometric biosensor, what we call bimodal waveguide interferometer. As you probably know, interferometer normally is done with Mach Zehnder architecture, where you have to divide it into arms that they are recombined again. And our idea was, is possible to do an interferometric device using just one single waveguide? So this was our idea, single channel waveguide interferometer. And then we decided why not to do that, but operating, but making the interferon using two modes of the light. So our idea was to start just injecting a monochromatic light and only supporting the fundamental mode. And then here in the device we grow a step junction, and then we excitate the fundamental mode and the first mode of the light. And since here, then the two modes are traveling together in the sensing area, and at the end they produce an interferometric pattern. So because in the sensing area we are located different biomolecules, then the two modes, the evanescent wave, the two modes interact differently with the molecules, and then that's the reason why they produce this interferometric pattern. Okay, this was the idea, and then we went to the lab, and then we make all the modelization, and we realized that because we want to use silicon photonics technology, we in biosensing, we always work in the visible range. So we decided to use silicon nitride for the fabrication of the waveguide. And then we realized that the only way to have this waveguide is having a thickness of 150 nanometer in the single mode region, and then 340 nanometer in the bimodal region to support only the two modes of the light. But more importantly, the waveguide, the width is below 3 microns, but because we're using RIP waveguide, the RIP depth is below 3 nanometers. So we need to control at the level of only a few nanometers in order to be able to control the propagation of only these two modes of the light. And then at this stage, we have a very robust and reproducible technology in our clean room facilities here in Barcelona, and we produce normally all this kind of all this wafer with containing all this chip. The chip has 20 biosensors in the interior, so you can see the sensing area of some of them. And then we just went to the lab and then started to produce, I mean, to make this sensitivity evaluation. And then we realized that our device was able to detect until a limit of detection of 10 minus 8 refractive index unit. So meaning that the device can be very, I mean, very sensitive in the low picogram per milliliter range. So we know that we have this, this is, has been one of the most sensitive magnetic wave biosensors that has been presented at the international level. It's a very simple one, have a very high level of multiplexing capabilities. In one chip, we have 20 biosensors, and importantly, it's operating in the visible range, very, very low cost instrumentation, and it's mass have a mass production in our clean room from this. Okay. I don't have time in the presentation to go for the details of how we make all the engineering to make to produce a point of care biosensor, a portable device. Just to mention that besides the technology, we also work in the polymer microfluidics, where we can, of course, we have individualized flow channel for each of the sensor. We work also on the cartridge development. And also, my group is also quite specialized in the surface biofunctionalization. So how you introduce all your biological receptor by chemical modification of the surface and chemical bonding. And this is one of the key steps in any biosensor. We know how to package and to storage of our cartridge. And we have been also working in the problem of the light uncoupling, because we are using nanometric waveguide in the modulation of the light, because it's an interferometric readout. And also the optical readout, the electronics, and so on. So you can see also in our publications and in our website. Just to mention only how we make about the surface biofunctionalization, I want just to mention, because you have to be aware that it's the key step in biosensing. I mean, even if it's very difficult to fabricate the transducer, and it could be very sophisticated how we fabricate on the silicon photonic chip, the most important step in my biosensor is you are able to know, I mean, to make a proper chemical modification of the surface, and then you are able to introduce in the right way your biological receptor. And also because you are going to deal with real samples, we want to use, for example, blood, serum, plasma, urine, 100%, I mean, without no filtering, without no sample pre-treatment. So mean that you have to develop anti-fouling strategies in order that your biological receptor is only detecting the molecule that you want to detect in these complex matrices. So this is also quite important, and we devote a long time to develop all the best strategies in order to be able to detect in real samples. So you can see also all the strategies that we use in our publications. Okay, so during the years, my group has shown how it's possible to use all these photonics, all these photonics technologies for different applications. Or, I mean, we have developed too many different applications for protein, for nucleotides, for a small organic molecule, also for pathogens, for bacteria. And also, we always end up demonstrating in real sample, and especially sample from pathogen, from hospital, how it's possible to use in the real time this sophisticated biosensing technology. Okay, so for example, this is our biosensor. We were able to detect, for example, bacteria in only 20 minutes, and we have a very astonishing limit of detection of only 4 bacteria per milliliter. Just taking samples from the acidic fluid for patients in the hospital, and directly in this acidic fluid, we were able to detect, for example, in this case with the E. coli bacteria, with this very low limit of detection. We have also demonstrated how with our technology, we can detect the late cancer stage of patients using some microRNA biomarkers directly also in urine. And we are able to stratify looking at a very small biomarker who is a healthy donor who has already ablated cancer. So we already demonstrated that with our technology. So we thought that we were very well prepared to tackle the problem with the diagnosis of the COVID-19. And in March 2020, we were granted by the European Union with one of the main of the first project for the diagnostic of the COVID-19. And also with partners from France and from Italy, we started to work in this project. And the idea of our project is how to use this ultra-sensitive photon biosensor that I showed you before, how it's possible to use as a point of care diagnostic for the early detection of the coronavirus. And also that we're, and also our idea in the project is that after we hope that the pandemic is ended very soon, then we can use also this device for the screening also of the prevention of the future outbreak, just measuring the coronavirus evolution in the reservoirs animal. So we are developing three different strategies for the diagnostic of COVID-19. Of course, the first one is the direct virus detection. We're detecting the whole virus. And the idea is to make in one step, a rapid step, I mean, between 15, 20 minutes. So we're detecting now the whole virus. This is a real-time diagnosis, one step. I mean, we just immobilize the corresponding antibody to the spike protein, and then we just detect the virus. And this is, and we are just targeting now how to do the test in saliva. And also because it's a biosensor, we are providing quantitative results. So we know what is the viral load of the pathogen. We are also developing a second biosensor that is a PCR-free genomic analysis. So while we're identifying the specific SARS-CoV-2 RNA sequences, so we just immobilize the complementary sequences to some of the ones completely specific to the SARS-CoV-2. We don't need any PCR amplification, so the test is done in 20 minutes. This also opened the possibility for a multiplexing capability in the future so that we can detect differentiate between COVID-19 and versus an influenza or versus a common cold. And also we have working a serological biosensor where we can detect and quantify the antibodies in blood serum. And also we just immobilize in that case the viral antigens and we detect the immunoglobulins from the pathogen. And again, this is sensitive, reliable, very fast, but it's also important. We can also quantify how many monoglobulins has produced a pathogen. So when we started with the project, of course, it was very difficult to work with directly with the SARS-CoV-2. And then for that reason, because we already prepared our biosensor with this antibody, the idea is to make this antibody mobilization, virus capture, and then the signal readout. So at the beginning of the pandemic, as I said, it was difficult to work with the SARS-CoV-2. So what we did is to use a pseudovirus. So just some colleagues from here in Spain, they were able to prepare a kind of pseudovirus where in the interior is a different RNA, so it's a non-infecting virus, but then they were able to express in the envelope of the virus the same spike protein that the SARS-CoV-2. So with this non-infective pseudovirus, we're able to see how by mobilizing the corresponding antibody to the X protein, we were able to see how our biosensor, the real-time signal from our biosensor, we were able to detect different concentration of this pseudovirus. We just tried with different antibodies and we were able to get more or less a very good limit of detection. This is like around 450 units of virus units per milliliter. We also check that it's completely specific. So when this pseudovirus have the spike protein in the envelope, then we're able to detect if we just use the regular pseudovirus without the spike protein, we were not able to see anything. And then with this good result, we decided just to start to work with the SARS-CoV-2. And then for that, we were just looking for different inactivation methods. So we have been working with ultraviolet inactivation and with thermal inactivation. And then we just check by a transmission electron microscopy that when a thermal inactivation, the virus was completely destroyed. But in the case of the ultraviolet inactivation, they were able to preserve the virus at the same time that it came not infected anymore. So we have BSL-2 facilities in our institute, and then with this inactivated SARS-CoV-2, we started to work with the direct detection of the SARS-CoV-2. So first we were using commercial antibodies, And then you can see from here that we get a very ascending limit of detection. We are below 100 virus per milliliter. And also we have a very large dynamic range. So it means that we can detect from 100 even to 10 to 7, 10 to 8 virus per milliliter. So it's not only that you have a low limit of detection, it's also important to have this very long dynamic range because the pathogen levels can be between 10 to 3, 10 to 5, 10 to 6. So we decided later on, because we are just relying on commercial antibodies, to prepare our own antibodies. And then with some collaborators in my same organization here in Spain, we have started to produce our own antibodies. And also now all these antibodies can be very easily adapted to the new variant. So it's not only that, for example, this one is the first variant from Wuhan, but then now we have antibodies for the different variants. So we can detect without any problem with this SLN limit of sensitivity. We have checked also, but also we even expected that that the sensitivity could be even higher when we're using the real SARS-CoV-2, because this is inactivated. It means that, they have some degree of the proteins and not completely, some of them can be denaturalized. The time to result is only 15 minutes, and then the clinical validation that we are performing is already ongoing. So we are really proud that we have this excellent result with our technology. So remember, this is label-free, no amplification, very fast, and also this excellent sensitivity that we can get. And we are also working with this PCR-free RNA biosensor. In that case, of course, we do need some sample pretreatment, because you need to take the sample, to take the RNA, and then to make some fragmentation. And what we do in our biosensor, we have prepared with complementary DNA probes. And we have selected three genes from the SARS-CoV-2 where we can detect. So we're detecting these three genes recommended by the WHO. So mean that we that the same one that they are using for the PCR. So we know that we have 100 specificity to SARS-CoV-2. So this is what we're doing now, just looking with the different genes with our biosensor. We have also very good level of sensitivity. But more importantly, what we are preparing is this is a multiplex biosensor where we can not only include the complementary probes or a receptor from the genes for the SARS-CoV-2, but we want also to have a multiplex biosensor in the future, for example, in the emergency rooms, emergency units, where we have the sequences for the SARS-CoV-2, for the influenza, for the common flu, for any kind of other similar virus. And then in that way, we can differentiate very easily when a pathogen is coming to the urgency, which one is the virus that is having this pathogen. Okay, and just to, the last one is the serological biosensor that we have already finished completely. So we were working with different viral antigens, and finally we realized, because we have excellent limit of detection with this, just evaluating in the serum of the patients, the presence of this, of the immunoglobulin that they have produced as a response to the SARS-CoV-2 infection. And then we decided to co-immobilize the M protein and the RBD peptide, and it was the best combination to give the highest sensitivity. We have performed an extended clinical validation, just an example here. You can see how the COVID negative, the condor, they did not signal at all. We took this sample from the biobank in the hospital in Spain from people, from the serum of people from 2017, in order to be completely sure that these people never get any contact with this coronavirus. And then you can see also the response from the serological analysis for the COVID-19 positive. And you can see how our biosensor is able to give a quantitative value of the immune response of each patient. As I said, we have performed with hundreds of samples and with a sensitivity close to 90%, specificity 100%, and you can see how we can differentiate without any problem the positive from the negative. This is already in Ken Akaike. If someone wants to take a look to this paper. So with this biosensor, we have an excellent sensitivity because this is, we can go even down to 0.01 microgram per milliliter. what is important, the time to result is only 15 minutes. We are using serum and blood serum is quantitative, and there is and we have performed a complete clinical validation, and now we are initiating the tech transfer to a commercial product. So, as a summary, what we are doing in the COVID-19 and is the approach to this combat European project is to develop, on one hand, this nanovirus sensor platform. And also, we are performing this antibody-based detection for the whole virus. We are also not finished already, but in good progress, a multiplex viral genomic analysis. Most importantly, in our project is, of course, I mean, now the main object, the main target is the patients, I mean, the human people, and how we can use in this in the COVID-19 diagnosis. But in the future, and also in the project, what we want to use our biosensor is to for the monitoring of the animal coronavirus evolution in order to prevent any outbreak in the future. And also we think that probably we hope that this COVID-19 probably once the pandemic is over, probably is going to be an endemic disease in humans. So we want to have prepared this point of care biosensor where we can differentiate it very easily. If you have just a coronavirus, I mean, you have COVID-19 or you have an influenza, a common cold, whatever, in a very fast way, in 15 minutes, in the emergency unit or even with your family doctor. So it's what we're doing, and we're still not finished. We still have 1 year more to finalize our project. Just as a general conclusion, I have to try to show you how this point of care for the biosensor probably is one of the most suitable analysis. Okay.
We are running a bit out of time, Laura.
Then finish here. Okay, just want to thank to my people that have been working even during all the pandemic, and also thank you for your attention.
Yeah, so thank you very much for the very inspiring and very interesting talk. Just we are running a bit out of time, therefore we should concentrate and give room for at least some important questions, which I will take the ones from the chat who have kicked in early. So one of the first question was given by Hedradi Hardianata, I hope I pronounced it correctly. And his first question was, what are the parameters required to produce a bimodal wave? For instance, the step height, refractive index, etc. What are the requirements?
Well, the requirements are we need for the modelization, of course. I mean, before doing the fabrication, so I mean, you can see also in our papers. And the main requirement is how you control the two modes of the light. You have to control the fundamental mode and the first mode of the light. So this is the main requirement. So means that you have to control the wavelength, you have to know the thickness of the layer and also the rip of our wet guide. So it's mainly the fabrication. And also we're using silicon nitride of 2.00 refractive index, and the cladding is silicon dioxide. So of course, I mean, this is parameter. So it's also in our publication, in our website, if they want to check.
Okay, and a connected question is, so in these bimodal waveguides, both of the modes see basically your virus layer on top, yeah? Yes. So why do you have this great sensitivity even though the both modes interact with the analyte?
Yeah, because the two modes has a different penetration evanescent wave. Okay, so the penetration of the evanescent field is different from the fundamental to the first mode. So it means that the first mode has more penetration. So it means that the fundamental is like a kind of a reference, and the first mode is the testing or the probe that is interacting with the biomolecule. So that's the main reason. I mean, they are not interacting. The evanescent wave, the evanescent profile is different. So it means that the interaction with the biomolecules is different from the two modes, and that's the reason why we have this interferometric result.
Okay, and last question, maybe before we go to the next talk, your impressive sensitivity of 10 to the minus 9, How was this achieved? So what's the main difference as compared to other interferometric sensors, which makes your system so much better?
No, no, I mean, the all the interferometric biosensor has the same sensitivity. So in our case, we go to 1 to 10 - 8. This is more or less what you can achieve with a Mach sender. Even when young interferometer, even sometimes some people have reported even 10 to -9. So the sensitivity is more or less the same for the interferometer. In the main advantage in my device is that we're using one single waveguide. So this is the main advantage. As you know, in Mach sender, in young interferometer, you have to use the Y-junction to divide it in two arms, and then you have to recombine again. So I mean that you need even more steps in the fabrication. Also, you can have more losses in this Y-junction. And that's the main advantage is that you have one single channel waveguide, and then you achieve an interferometric readout. This is the main. And also, you can fabricate even more sensors in the same side, that for example, in the same chip, than, for example, using Mach sender, that you need more space because you need the Y-junction and so on.
Okay. Thank you very much again for this very interesting presentation. But okay, due to the advanced time,
I will answer the other question in the chat. Okay.
Thank you very much.